evening, friends. Good evening, friends, and welcome to our Evensong Worship for Ash Wednesday. We have gathered here tonight to start our journey to the cross with Jesus through silence, singing, scripture, and spoken words. Let us begin our journey. Told no one any of the things they had seen. Let us pray. Father, I know I wanted to spend time with you, but I am so easily distracted. Forgive me for my undisciplined thoughts. Help me to learn to sit quietly at your feet without a million thoughts distracting me. Teach me, Lord, how to be still. Thank you for daily reminding me that when I am weak, you are strong. In the name of Jesus, I pray.
The power and the glory forever.
Amen.
Please stand as together we read the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, verses 33 through 38 in unison. Let us begin.
When they came to the place that is called the skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine, and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews."
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To them later tonight for the work that they put in to this service and the preparations that they've made to help lead us in our beginning of Lent. Quick reminder that there were cards, connection cards at the back if you have not filled that out yet. You don't have to get up and get it now. I'd ask that you do that on your way out the door this evening and just leave them at the back on that stand as well, and we will collect them. So I assume that by now, most of you, if not all of you, have seen Mel Brooks' The Passion of the Christ. Is that a familiar movie to you? Well, that movie, because of its popularity several years ago, has kind of been imprinted on what we view as the crucifixion. I imagine when the Chosen series gets to that point, that will also impact our view of the crucifixion as well. We need to suspend some of our thoughts about the crucifixion during this season that we're going to be entering. We're going to be talking about the seven last words of Christ during the season of Lent. So, figuratively speaking, Jesus is going to be on the cross for 6 weeks. We're going to be pausing the 3 hours from when they nailed him to the cross and until he passed away for quite some time, and take a deep dive look at Jesus on the cross. Now that's 6 weeks, and that could be a long period of time. That's going to be a weight for us to bear, perhaps a weight that is too much for us. Yes, Jesus is dying. These words that we will be studying, we need to focus on. We need to hear what he's saying to us. And I suspect we usually skip over this part. We don't like to see Jesus on the cross. We don't really want to stick around too long during these verses of Scripture. We actually want to skip ahead. We have hindsight. We know what's about to happen in 3 days. But we're going to hit pause for 6 weeks and stay at the foot of the cross. See, we have an awesome amount of respect for the last words of someone as they're dying The martyrs of our faith are remembered for holding on to Christ, even with their very last words as they were tortured to death. The convicted murderer, when they are sentenced to death for a blessing or a curse for society, has an opportunity once again to either confess or accost us once more. We believe in the last words so much that we give them an opportunity. Legally, a last will and testament are important, legally binding words on how to dispense with a person's assets when they pass away. I studied some late 18th and 19th century wills and what they say in there. Not the legalese that we have today. Sometimes it's very personal words to their loved ones. Sometimes they're very touching, comforting words. Other times they're tragic slaps in the face as to how they really don't like so-and-so. We place importance on last words, as if this is the climax of life. It's the takeaway for their story. Yet with Jesus, we skip the words, we skim the crucifixion, we jump straight to that resurrection because we have hindsight. We know the good news is on the way. If there's good news in these seven last words, and if we jump ahead, we miss those words. So let's rewind, let's slow down for this time period. We know he's going to die. We know what we see up there is gruesome. But pause and listen to the words of Christ. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. What a offer you an opportunity, since we're a little bit more informal here than we normally are on Sunday mornings, give you a chance to respond. Who do you think Jesus is referring to when he speaks these words, Father, forgive them? Who's them? I'll take Charles. The youth can come in too.
The people who were caught up in the mass.
The mess that's all around Jesus. The crowds have been stirred up. They were like, crucify him! They didn't even know who Jesus, may not even recognize Jesus. He's all bloody and beaten there. But the high priests are saying, crucify him, crucify. Right? They don't know what they're doing. Forgive them. Anyone else?
I think everybody, I mean, even today.
Everybody.
Everybody. We reject Christ today. We reject the Bible.
Yeah.
And don't look at it.
So even us today, there are folks today who are rejecting God's word. They need forgiveness. About the soldier that just hammered a nail through his feet and hands. I know in Luke's gospel it's recorded in a slightly different arrangement, but how about the Pharisees that are mocking him? Or the soldiers who also mock him and had all night at that point? The thief, who we'll hear from this Sunday, one of the two of them, mocked Jesus. You know, all of these are possibilities. We've even seen a picture of an angry God, right? Has anybody seen those pictures of an angry God with lightning bolts in his hand, ready to just strike down at an instance? Maybe Jesus is up on the cross. He's got his arms open wide, but it's not towards us. It's towards God. No, don't do it! Father, Daddy, forgive him! The I mean, they are really mistreating the son right now. Any of you that are parents, if your kid's getting bullied, hair on the back of your neck starts to stand up. Right? They're getting dangerously close to a supernatural outpouring of God's holy wrath in this moment. Jesus is trying to hold them back. That's not really an accurate picture of God the Father, though. So if that's not an accurate picture of God the Father, that wrathful, thunderbolt-throwing punisher, then this is not an accurate picture of what Jesus is saying at that moment. Father, forgive them. Don't hold this against them. That very moment. So maybe these words are about the mocking that Jesus is receiving at that very moment. It's a personal prayer of forgiveness. And in a traditional sense, when you pray to forgive someone, someone were to come against me and to mistreat me, and I want to truly forgive them in my heart, I also want to ask that God forgives them, that within me I'm praying, Father, forgive them. And that my prayer is me forgiving them. Jesus, doing that, is not saying that they've wronged the Father. Jesus is praying forgiveness in the Father's name for those who have wronged him. And that's a nice way of looking at it, if we want to look at it like that. Jesus did say to forgive those who sin against us. And certainly being convicted in a kangaroo court on more than one occasion that previous night, beaten mercilessly multiple times, whipped until the flesh on his back was taken off of the bone, mocked. Those things would all count as needing forgiveness. However, the next phrase makes me think that that's a weak understanding of what Jesus is saying. When he says, Father, forgive them, he adds, for they know not what they do. Who doesn't know what they're doing? Soldiers knew what they were doing. They're carrying out orders. Pilate knew what he was doing. He was stopping the mob. The chief priests knew what they were doing. They were trying to retain power. Doesn't know what they're doing. I want to refer you back to the passage that we read towards the beginning of the service, the Mount of Transfiguration. Peter is up there on the mountain, and in verse 33 of chapter 9, Peter says this, Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And Luke adds, not knowing what he said. There's this wonderful, glorious sight before the three disciples. And the best thing that he can think to say is, let's build some monuments. Now, we all love Peter, and I love to pick on him too, so here we go. The reason we like to pick on Peter is because we're Peter. We get to pick on ourselves. Peter loves to put his mouth into gear before his brain has even warmed up. And he does it all the time. Lord, if that's really you out there, call me out on the water. I'll never betray you. No, sir. Let's stop talking about all this death and crucifixion stuff. We're going to go to Jerusalem for a party. No, Lord, I have never eaten anything unclean in my life, nor touched Peter almost chronically has this no idea what to say syndrome. It just keeps coming up multiple times. And he has no idea who he's talking to each time that he says something like this. How often have we been in a similar situation? You see, when Jesus is hanging on the cross, he's freshly nailed up there for everyone to see and ridicule. Shock probably hasn't set in just yet, so he's in pain. When Jesus says, "Father, forgive them," they don't know what they're doing. He's talking about you, and he's talking about me. Talking about everyone in this whole wide world that needs to hear that they are forgiven. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. We need forgiveness because we don't know what we're doing. We've worked against the holy love of God in little ways and big ways and ways of commission, that's things we do, and in ways of omission, the things we've left undone. Our prayer of confession starts out like this: "We confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone." When Adam and Eve hid in the garden in Genesis chapter 3, God went searching for them. You all remember this story from the very beginning of Scripture. And Genesis 3 records this crazy question that God asks as he enters the garden. Do y'all remember what God asked? "Adam, where are you?" Now, does anyone in this room for a moment think the omniscient, all-knowing God doesn't know where Adam is? Is there something that, okay, God just conveniently for the moment decided to forget where Adam was so that he could ask this question? No. God was not asking that question for his own benefit. God asked that question because Adam no longer knew where he was. Adam was lost. Adam had lost himself. And he didn't know what he was doing anymore. Now, add a few thousand years, compress upon that sin after sin among humanity, and we end up where Jesus is hanging on the cross and he prays, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." That's why we have this great hymn that, since it's been written, every generation of the church has loved: "I once was lost, but now I'm found. Because Christ has found us." And with all the sincerity in the world, we can lift up offerings, and those offerings will still just be dirty rags if it weren't for Christ. And Christ comes, and when our best is a Ford Pinto, which these guys here don't know what a Ford Pinto is, but it's a really junky car. Even when it was brand new, it was a junky car. And yet wrapped up in Christ, that junk car can become a fully loaded Hummer. Like $1 million car. Because of Christ and his grace and mercy. We don't know what we're doing. Jesus knew exactly what he was doing. right where our need is, Jesus can take that just as we are and he can remake it. Jesus can reframe our negatives, our lacks, our not knowingness. When we depend on him, he offers us forgiveness and does everything for us. He takes care of us because he knows how, even when we don't know. Now, doesn't that sound like God? God knows. God's able. God's willing. Yeah. That's who we think of when we think of God. That's the kind of God who loves you enough to send Jesus Christ because we don't know what we're doing. And God shows us, and God empowers us, and the proof in our life is the Holy Spirit living in us. And if you've never given your heart to God, then you can know that. God doesn't ask for perfection. He even forgives when we don't know we need to ask for forgiveness. Because God loves us. If you've never taken that kind of step to commit your life to Christ, I ask you to do that this evening. You can come forward tonight if you'd like to. You can send me a message. I'd love to chat with you about it. I'm not going to embarrass you. That's not what I do. I want to pray with you, and I want you to hear the words of assurance that God forgives you. And God knows, even when we don't. And that you can get started on a lifelong journey with Jesus Christ. Now, maybe you have given your life to Christ, as I suspect many in this room may have already. Yet you're dealing with some things right now that have torn you apart. Some things you might know about, some things you just don't understand, but your heart's getting pulled and rended in different ways. And you want to scream out and say, I don't know what I'm doing. Something has held you back. Well, when Christ went to the cross, he said these words for you. He gave you a space so that you could feel free and safe to admit, I don't know what I'm doing. He's giving you a good place to land in his arms. Again, you can come forward, you can chat with me this evening. You can give me a message this week, see me on Sunday. I just want to pray. I'm not even going to ask you details that you don't want to give me. But we can chat, and you can hear the words of forgiveness that God gives you. And you can rest assured in his love. And we'll pray. We'll ask that God shows you when we don't know. God's grace is not for us alone. So I'd also ask that you think about those who aren't with us this evening, who may need to hear that they too, even though they don't know us, are forgiven. So who could you share this word of forgiveness with? Share it with them. Pray with them and pray for them. So I ask you to take a moment as we bow our heads and go to God together this evening. Son Jesus Christ, you have reconciled the world to yourself. Help us now to be reconciled with one another, that again we might dwell in the warmth of your love. Inspire us with your Holy Spirit to put aside the cloak of pride and put on Christ, that we might forgive and be forgiven, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Sometimes we just don't know what we're doing. Jesus knew and still knows exactly what he's doing. Right where our need is, Jesus can take it just as we are, remake it. I'd like to invite the youth back as they continue to lead us in receiving the sign of ashes this evening.
When we reconcile our relationships with others, we say that we are sorry and ask for forgiveness. This is why we are here tonight, to show God that we are sorry for our sins and to ask for forgiveness as we begin our Lenten journey. This is what Jesus meant when he said in the Gospel, change your lives and believe in the Gospel.
This evening we show this in a very special way. These ashes, when they are placed on our forehead, we are saying to God, Father, we are sorry for our sins. Can we start over again with your forgiveness? Because we have faith, we know that God will always love us and forgive us. Let us thank God now for the gift of these blessed ashes.
Let us pray.
Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. Grant that these ashes may be to us a sign of our mortality and penitence, so that we may remember that only by your gracious gift are we given everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
As we prepare to remember this evening, we've got three stations. Braden and Natalie are going to be imposing ashes by their finger on your forehead. If you prefer not to be on your forehead and you want to receive ashes still, just put your hand on your forehead like this, and they'll put it on the back of your hand. That way they don't have to ask everybody. Just go ahead and put your hand up there, okay? And they'll put it on the back of your hand. If you're not comfortable this evening, we know that COVID is still an issue for us, and some of us are having different levels of comfort. We have a station in the back where there's Q-tips, and you can take a Q-tip, dip it into the ashes, and sign yourself, and then just throw the Q-tip away in the trash can by the side there. But you're welcome to do either one that you're comfortable with this evening. Would invite that if you're sitting on this side, that you'd come down this way and go to Natalie. Or if you're on this side, to come down this way and go to Braden. If you're going to the back, just come to the center and go to the back station to serve yourself with the ashes. Come, receive this moment of grace as we repent and call on Christ, who says, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing.
Is now satisfied. God's word calls us to forgiveness and love. As one body in Christ, let us offer our prayers for all who look to us for forgiveness and love. Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. That all of us will speak to God in daily prayer, especially during this season of Lent, and listen to his spirit within us, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we will change ourselves by being more aware of our thoughts, words, and actions, and try to grow more like Christ each day, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Jesus, the light of the world, will guide us to help others in a true spirit of love by speaking God's words of peace and encouragement, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. God of love, you call us out of darkness, and you give us the grace to respond to your call. Grant that we may follow Jesus closely during this special time of prayer and penance. Send your Holy Spirit to direct our ways. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the early Christians observed with great devotion the days of our Lord's passion and resurrection, and it became the custom of the church that before the Easter celebration there should be a 40-day season of spiritual preparation. During this season, converts to the faith were prepared for holy baptism. It was also a time when persons who had committed serious sins and had separated themselves from the community of faith were reconciled by penance and forgiveness, and restored to the participation in the life of the church. In this way, the whole congregation was reminded of the mercy and forgiveness proclaimed in the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the need we all have to renew our faith. I invite you, therefore, in the name of the church, to observe a holy Lent by self-examination and repentance, by prayer, fasting, and self-denial, by reading and meditating on God's holy word, to make a right beginning of repentance. And as a mark of our mortal nature, let us bow our hearts before our Creator and Redeemer. The ashes placed on your foreheads this day remind us that our lives are brief, and that all we are and all we have come God, our Creator. Begin your Lenten time of daily reflection, of reading, prayer, and giving today. You're invited to use the Cup of Salvation devotional if you do not have a devotional of your own, or to add this to your daily reading. This book is offered by the Intentional Faith Development team as we journey together to the cross. May the tender compassion of our God dawn from on high and break upon us to shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet to the way of peace. Amen.